Hey, so today we're working on a 2004 Hyundai Sonata. The customer has no AC. They've had it at a shop. The compressor has failed, so we're going to go ahead and replace the compressor, the expansion valve, the receiver dryer. We're also going to be putting a condenser in it. This condenser looks has corrosion, looks maybe original. We're going to go ahead and do that one as a performance enhancing something so we don't have to relive this later for a failed condenser, or we don't compromise our new compressor. So we're going to add and add that to the repair. So what we're going to do first is we are going to start with doing the condenser. So what we're going to do is we'll be removing the radiator mounts, moving the radiator just slightly back enough to remove the condenser. So we'll go ahead and start by disconnecting some lines. All right, so we're gonna go ahead now and loosen up. These are the two mounting brackets for the radiator. Now what we need to do is we have the radiator and condenser, but they are mounted together and still to the frame here. So we have a 10 millimeter on the top of each one of the pedestals. That'll release one of the brackets from the radiator to the condenser. We do have one electrical connector on the dryer here. So we just want to push in the tab and pull that one up. We'll go ahead and tuck it over to the side. All right, so now we want to do these two bolts here. There's another bracket. So we want to go ahead and remove those two bolts to get that bracket off. All right, so now we want to remove this shield right here. We have two lower bolts connecting the condenser to the radiator. So we have three bolts here. This will take this panel down so we can access that bolt. All right, so we'll go ahead and get these two lower bolts, one here, also one on the other side. All right, so now we're going to go ahead and do the other side. I've already got the ratchet positioned. So this bolt is also most likely going to be rusty. It'll be a good one. But we'll go ahead and take this bolt. This should be the last bolt holding the condenser and the accumulator in. So we'll go ahead and loosen that now. To make it a little bit easier, now we could pull the radiator out. I believe the book says pull the radiator out. So we want to pull the condenser out. So we have the condenser loose. We have the accumulator over here. So we could remove the accumulator, pull the condenser out. But on reinstalling, we would have to reinstall the accumulator in the vehicle. So what we're going to do is this also comes off here. We'll go ahead. There's four bolts here and one on the bottom. We'll start with these four. We may be able to get a little bit of more room here so we can assemble our accumulator and our condenser out of the vehicle to put it in. So we'll go ahead and we'll remove these. Okay, so we do have another bolt. This bracket goes all the way down, has one bolt holding on the bottom of this bracket. So we'll go ahead and get that one. Okay, so now that is really loose. We'll go ahead and move it forward a little bit. Move our wire out of the way so we don't get it pinched. Take this a little farther. There's a power steering hose attached to that bracket. We'll go ahead and take that off. Try to get a little bit more. Just kind of lift it out of the way. Come on. There we go. So the reason why we're replacing the condenser, a lot of corrosion. This is the seam line, so we just don't want to have any problems once we bring the vehicle back up to the correct pressure. So we know the outside is corroded. We want to take our old part. Here's our new condenser we got from Auto Parts Direct to You. What we want to do is we want to just make sure that we have everything is correct. Looks like, you know, we're gonna have to put an accumulator on it. Looks like we're gonna have to remove the pressure switch from it. All right, so everything looks pretty good here. Good on the other side. So there is some small things we may have to transfer over. So it looks like the piece for the where the screw went in, They are here, but this one had the one screw that went down through it. So we're gonna have to remove this insert and move it over here. It's like for both sides. We'll see how that one works out. But there may be a couple pieces, but. All right, so we wanna remove this sensor here. We also want to retrieve some bolts. We need this 10 millimeter. We're also going to need these. All right, so we're going to go ahead and put everything back together. All right, so our new compressor does not come with any oil in it. So we're going to be installing oil too. Now, the oil is only necessary in the compressor, but the oil does make its way around the system. It is an enclosed system. So what we want to do is we're just going to put a little bit of oil into the accumulator. The accumulator, what takes away the moisture inside also absorbs the oil too. So we're going to go ahead and preload the accumulator with just a tiny bit of oil, maybe a cap full. We're just trying to help out the system make its full circulation on the first startup. But once the vehicle starts and starts pumping, the refrigerant makes its way, the oil and the refrigerant move together. But the primary use of the oil is the lubrication of the compressor. So we'll go ahead and just put about a cap full in here. We're going to lube up all of our O-rings and stuff so everything fits nicely. So we'll go ahead and start reinstalling now. We made the connection now. It sits a little funny here. There is gonna be a little bit of tweaking on the line, just a tiny bit. And then it made it sit a little bit more flush was the goal there. Yes. Okay, so now we wanna put our sensor on. See, we already have an O-ring there. We want to go ahead and transfer that one out to use our new O-ring. Go ahead and put a little lube on that. I'll go ahead and put our cap full in there now. This isn't necessary. It's just a precaution just to kind of help the fluid make its way around. All right, so now we'll go ahead and reinstall the condenser to the radiator. Just want to make sure that we kind of brush off what was there. Things tend to build up in between the two. It makes it through the condenser, but then doesn't make it through the radiator. So we want to make sure the airflow is good. Go ahead and knock all that off. Now when we put this back in, we're going to be very careful. You know, we don't want to push, you know, change the direction of the fins so that the air doesn't flow. So we want to make sure that for the radiator and the condenser, we don't compromise anything there. So we'll go ahead and all right, so we're gonna reinstall those inserts on the sides. We'll do one at a time. I did all four of these bolts, the top and then the two bottom ones we did from below. I got them all hand started so that I know that all four corners are going to bolt up and it is centered and all that. So now we'll go ahead and retighten all of those, so we'll fasten it down. Now that we got all these tight, this one here was the one we did from below. It was real tight. With the radiator and this core support bracket out, I have a ratcheting wrench that I could fit in there and do the same thing I did just on top. So now we'll go ahead and we're gonna put the rest of the front end up together here. When I take stuff apart, I like to group my bolts together, so I put all the core supports all in the same spot. Everything that held the condenser, I put those all in the same spot. All right, so now we're going to reinstall our air diverter. All right, so then we'll reattach our power steering line. Reattach our bumper. Alright, so now I want to plug in our connector. Go ahead and snake it back through. We should have done that first. Okay. So go ahead and connect our connector back in. Our tabs are this way. All right, so now we want to do the compressor and the expansion valve. So we have all the condenser and we have our receiver dryer here. Now I still have the caps on the lines, so I'm not exposing this to moisture, mainly the condenser. That is what's going to be our moisture catch. So if I have it open, we're here in Florida. It is very humid here. Every minute that this thing would be open to the system, it would be absorbing moisture, which would take away our efficiency later on. So we are going to spend a little bit more time doing the rest of these. I don't want to hook the lines up because they go, one goes to the compressor. We want to kind of leave those off. So supplied with the condenser are always caps. So we have that capped off right now. So we are sealed. We don't have to worry about that. Right now. All right, so I want to unplug the electrical connector. Oh, that thing looks pretty brittle. Oh, very brittle. So a pretty brittle connector there. We're going to have to replace that. We'll go ahead and worry about that once we get the compressor out. All right, so we'll go ahead and we're going to remove these two lines here. There's some 10 millimeter studs. So now we'll go ahead and remove the serpentine belt. Now the serpentine belt has a little spot for your wrench down at the end of it for your ratchet. Go ahead and loosen the tensioner, pull the belt. That's a bad spot right there. I have to put the belt back on. Reposition the tensioner. Go at it again. Okay. All right, so now we have the belt off the compressor. I will raise the car back up. The compressor's got four mounting bolts, so we'll go ahead and take those off. All right, so we have four bolts holding the compressor. We'll go ahead and remove this. This is the oil pressure sensor. So it's a hidden little button, but we just push down on it and pull it off. All right, so we'll go ahead and get these four mounting bolts. Okay, so I just tried to, I got the first bolt loose. I tried to pull the bolt out. It does not want to come out. Meaning, when I say doesn't want to come out, there's not enough room to pull it out. So when we put the new compressor in, we have to remember to add the bolts prior to getting it mounted up. All right, so now we got the last bolt. We got our other two bolts still in there because they don't come out because of the distance.
So we have to watch that because
if we're moving the compressor around and they do fall backwards, they'll hang up stuff so we can't get to it, so. So we're really concerned about hitting that oil pressure sensor right there. That ultimately is in our way. And so we're gonna go ahead and remove the oil pressure switch. Now we could remove, there's a cover over here, we got some lines in the way. I mean, we could probably find another route. This seems to be the simplest. I mean, even removing the oil filter would have been something to do. So we just turn it. Pressure going upwards. See, there's that bolt I was talking about. If it slides out, it can make it harder. All right. So we got our compressor out. Okay, looks like we have some mounting extensions we need to pay attention for. All right, so here we have our new compressor from Auto Parts Direct U. So we're going to go ahead and we'll check out some differences. So we have to transfer our top line 90s over. The spacer is attached. There's the new one. So we just want to make sure that everything is the same. So there's our connector. We have a new side. Now we broke the inner. So that inner is what, oh, that is a pretty brittle connector. So we'll go ahead and we already have the base side. The vehicle side is what we're real concerned about. Now, so you just want to make sure everything is the same, you know, the amount, the distance. So we went ahead and normally this sticker is over top of the lines where you would be, you know, servicing, where you would be playing. When you flip this thing upside down, it does have a note. It says this compressor contains 7 ounces or 180 cc's of peg oil. So unless the system had rear air, we don't have to add any more oil. This vehicle calls, I believe, somewhere in that 170 to 190 cc's is what the range was for this vehicle. So we're okay with the factory installed AC oil. So we're just going to go with that one. So we'll go ahead and we'll transfer our lines over now. Okay, so we have our new O-rings installed there. What we want to do is we'll go ahead and clean this up a little bit. Looks like there's from the oil residue and sand. We'll go ahead and we'll break clean these off, try to get all just the sand and whatnot out of the way. We've got our 90s all cleaned up, mounted on the new compressor. Now the other thing we have noticed is this bracket right here comes on the factory one. So this is where the hold down is for the clutch coil. There's also another one here that would be the wiring harness for the O2 sensor. So we're going to go ahead and transfer this over. This is always a good idea. That way all your wiring is secure, you know, so nothing else could happen. Loose wire, catch the belt, something strange. We'll just make sure everything is how it should be. We do have a different size bolt, one odd size bolt. That odd side bolt is going to be the one with the extension on it. So go ahead and we'll put our top bolts in. The bottom ones we can slide in. We'll go ahead and put these in. We'll put the compressor up. We'll get it tightened down. We'll go ahead and put our oil sensor in so we're not dripping. Okay, all right, so we're all tight there. All right, so we got our wiring harness. We'll go ahead and that should click back on. All right. All right. There's one of our lines. We tucked it away. There's another line we tucked away. Go ahead and replace our O-rings there. Right, so we're going to, I'm just going to oil the tips of the O-ring, try to be very careful and slip them back into the spot so we're not touching any of the dirt and grime and getting it on there. Okay, so both lines are in their spot. I do not have the nuts, they're up top. But we have that set. Okay, so we'll go ahead and put the nuts on the lines there. Tighten those up. Okay, so we'll go ahead and we'll attach these lines here now. So we got to find some new O-rings. So we had one supplied O-ring there. Doesn't look like the small one came with it. All right, so now we'll go ahead and put the belt on. So now the expansion valve. All right, so we have three bolts, two, and then one in the center. So go ahead and do the outer ones first. Oh, that was pretty tight. All right, so we have a pain in the butt going on. We have an Allen that's not so good. So it's either super corroded, it's hard to see, or it's rounded, but it is looking like it's rounded. All right, so we basically cut the head off of the bolt there, so we still have to pull the bolt out, but at least we got it all free and we're moved on to the next step. So we want to use a pair of vice grips to go ahead and remove the stud. Right now, so we want to replace the rear O-rings. We'll go ahead and match those up. All right, so here we have our new expansion valve that we got from Auto Parts Direct U. Go ahead and make sure everything looks good, everything's the same. This one has a cap on it, only difference. So go ahead and pour a little bit of lube on the O-rings there. Go ahead and get these O-rings off and replace too, and we'll go ahead and put the whole unit in as one. All right, so we went ahead, we've got another bolt supplied to us by Auto Parts Direct U. So we'll go ahead and reinstall the expansion valve. All right, so we'll go ahead and put back our, this is the cruise control. We had to remove it so we could get in there and cut that bracket away. We did have some other wires, so we want to make sure that everything goes back. There was a ground wire. We had another bracket. So now we have to go back and readdress that broken wiring connector there. So here we have a pigtail that we got from Auto Parts Direct U. So last one of these that we did, we just popped the connector and the wire out the backside and reinstalled it into the plastic. This time, what we're going to do is we're going to actually solder and splice this one in. So we'll show you how to do that, how to make a good connection there for you. We have our pigtail. So this is the link that we had before. So what we don't want to do is, I mean, it wouldn't be ideal to just cut it at the very end, add the pigtail. Now we have more length of wire. This is usually not a good idea. So we'll try to keep it somewhat in the same length, maybe just a hair longer. We don't want it to, you know, blow around with the air and catch on anything or touch the exhaust or, you know, so we're trying to keep all that as original as possible. So we're going to peel back this connector. We're going to get into this plastic sheeting. We're going to make our connection about 2 inches or so. We don't want to do it too short where we don't have any room. So we're going to go about right here. That gives us plenty of room to work with, and then it'll be able to cover it back up. So go ahead and we'll get this wire to the size so we want. So there's a little cut in the side of that wire loom there so we can get some back. So we'll go ahead and we'll do our splice right around here. We'll give ourselves somewhere in between an inch and 3/4 of an inch worth of exposed wire. We'll twist it together. All right, so we got that side prepped. Now we'll go ahead and prep our other side. So we know we're somewhere in this length. So we're gonna go ahead and just give ourselves just a hair bit more. So go ahead and strip the seam back here. So we got both of our wires stripped and twisted. Now we're gonna get a piece of heat shrink. We'll put the heat shrink on the wire. That's the longest. This is the base side. That way we can get the heat shrink as far away from our solder point as possible. So we don't add any heat to that yet. We won't be ready for that. All right, so we'll go ahead and give it some more exposure of the wire down below out of the harness there. We'll slip that piece way down there. All right, so once we make the connection, we can slide that back. So that piece of heat shrink is pretty close to the same size as the wire, just a hair bit. So when we twist these wires together, we don't want to get a bulge because we won't be able to slide it over. But we want to just kind of keep it in a nice, the same kind of diameter there. So we'll split the two differences in the size and kind of loop them together, kind of twisting them. Sometimes twisting together, sometimes twisting one around the other. I'm going to make sure that we have it all pretty straight as possible. So now we've got the wires in the fashion that we want. So we'll go ahead and now we'll apply solder to that and make that a permanent connection that we will not have problems with later on. I normally use a board. This board's a little big. Something to get a little back pressure when I'm soldering with the gun, so I have something I can press up against. That works out good there. Yeah, we'll go ahead and kind of bend that around so it. So a nice pressure point. I do have a rag with water just in case anything. One is to clean, just to have something here. So this is a propane soldering iron. We'll go ahead and get her going. And so we can kind of see it's lit in there. So we'll go ahead and get that nice and hot. Then we have some resin, solder we want to have, rosin core. So basically, the center of this has a flux inside of it. So that flux is going to help the bond and the impurities. So we can smell we're getting hot. I'll take my wet rag, I just want to clean the tip up. You can see we got real shiny there at the end. Steel wool, sometimes sandpaper. Sandpaper is really aggressive, so it will remove material. So now we got it, we're pretty hot. All right, so we apply a little bit. All right, so we want to just go ahead and now we're going to get the wire hot, kind of press it on there, and we can kind of feed the solder into. Now you can see why I have my board there. So once the wire gets hot, it's going to start sucking in some solder. Then we kind of just want to move that solder around. move that solder around and kind of get everywhere that we had twisted pretty tight. All right, we want to let it cool. If we yank on it right now, we'll probably pull it apart. Let that cool down just a little bit. All right, so now we have a good bond there. So it's still pretty hot. If I try to push my heat shrink on top of that, because it's still kind of warm, it will start activating the heat shrink, and it may make it shrink too fast for him, and I might not be able to get it all the way across. So we'll just give it here just a few seconds to get cool. It should cool down pretty quick. All right. So go ahead and want to push our heat shrink right over top. We can use the same soldering iron. We just run the side of the. It blows heat out of one side. So we can kind of just blow a little bit of that heat, rolling the wire around. It should tighten that heat shrink up. All right, so this is a connection that is like a butt connector. It's going to give you a lot of room for corrosion, and then resistance starts increasing. The wire gets hot in that spot. This is not exposed to the outside, the heat shrink, and this is probably the best connection you're going to be able to get. All right, so we're all done with that repair there. All right, so we'll go ahead and put our wire back into our wire loom. So here we have it back in the wiring loom. We're gonna go ahead and we're gonna put that factory cover back on there too. So this cover here is to hold the wiring loom in place. All right, so there we go. There's a factory wiring repair. So go ahead and we'll plug the compressor back in. All right, so now we are systems all together. We'll go ahead and put it under a vacuum. Leave it there for about 30 minutes or so, sucking out all the residual moisture. And then that'll also ensure that we have sealed the system up, because we'll be able to hold the vacuum. All right, so now we have our vacuum pump all hooked up. We have our gauges closed. 0, because we obviously had the system open. There's nothing in it, all that good stuff. So we're going to go ahead and turn the vacuum pump on and introduce the vacuum. So once we introduce the vacuum, we'll drop down. We'll go ahead and we'll apply it on both sides. So this is what's going to suck down all the moisture out of the system. It's going to make it pretty, the AC as efficient as it's going to be. The other thing that it does for us is once we're in a vacuum, we'll go ahead and cut it off when we're charging it. This will help take that first load of Freon in, because it's going to want to pull. So what we just did here is we gave it a quick vacuum. We've done turning it back off. So we have a complete vacuum locked into the system. And we're watching the gauge there to see if it goes down or not. So it may drop a little bit at first, but it'll stabilize. There. So go ahead and open it back up. That's just a quick check. If we lost all of our vacuum once we isolated it, we would be, what'd we put on wrong? What O-ring didn't sit right? But being able that it holds vacuum, we know that the system is holding pressure. So we'll go ahead and let this sit for about a half hour. All right, so now we've had the vehicle on vacuum, maybe 45 minutes we've had it here. We'll go ahead and shut the valves off. Turn the vacuum pump off. So we've got all the moisture out of the system. We're sitting on a vacuum and we are holding our pressure. That's telling us that all of our connection points are good. So we'll go ahead and get ready to shoot some Freon into the system. Now on the vehicles, usually they have a sticker somewhere that tells you oil and refrigerant specifications. So this says refrigerant 675 to 725 grams. So what you get in the normal, this is more homeowner or more automotive do-it-yourself stuff. You don't need a license to buy this, but you should have a license to handle it and all that stuff. Could get really hurt with this. You could freeze yourself, get freezing burns, really hurt. So each one of these cans has 340, so almost two cans. This is a can tap for this one. This is so we can do it by our line. Most of the homeowner or the do-it-yourself stuff is gonna be a can with the line attached, so you can directly go to the low side. This is, you know, attachment so that you can use cans with a gauge set. All right, so here we have our first can. We've held our vacuum, so we've ensured that we have no leaks. We've held here for about 5 or 10 minutes. So system is not running. We're under vacuum. This will be our time where the system will actually draw in the Freon versus using the compressor to draw in the Freon. So we're always going to charge off of the low side. So we'll go ahead and open the line. This first can will take almost maybe half of it before we run out of the pressure differences. All right, so that's as much transfer we have. I will go ahead and shut off the gauges again. We'll start the car up and then we'll turn the AC on. That should cycle it, and then we will finish shooting in the rest of that can. So I did hear the system cycle on. So we'll go ahead and start adding some Freon. So you can see we're slowly building pressure. Ideally, when we get to the end of this, we're going to be somewhere just under 40, right around 40, just under 40. We're going to be somewhere 250, 300-ish, 275, right around there somewhere. We start to get 350, we're definitely getting high pressure. That means we are restricted. We went ahead and replaced the condenser, so that's really not gonna be a problem that we have there. But if the condenser had some plugged up, wasn't flowing right, that's where that back pressure would come from the extreme high pressure. All right, so we're getting pretty close on the bottom of that. One of the other ones is the expansion valve.
The thicker line's the low side, smaller line's the high side. The smaller line's gonna get hot, the big line's gonna get cold. That's telling you that the condenser and the Freon levels are getting up to where it's doing its job. So we're starting, the expansion block is cold. High side is getting warm. All right, so we're done. We're done with this one. All right, so what we're gonna do before we do the next bottle, we're gonna shut the vehicle off, turn all the valving off, shut the vehicle off. We're gonna let the system equalize from the high side and the low side. The gauges will actually equal up, and then we'll cycle it again, putting in our second can of Freon there. Okay, so we're getting pretty close, 100. We're still 125, but we're getting pretty close to equalizing. We'll go ahead and start it back up now, and we'll start charging that second can, and so that our system is topped off. Ready? All right, so now we have our two cans shot. So we put 680 grams of Freon in. So we're on the low side of our spec. 675 would be the low side. So we're pretty good. Judging by the gauges, we're looking pretty good. We're standing out here in almost 100 degree heat with no wind in the back of a shop. So that is showing us on the gauge here. That's why we're a little higher. Once we got out on the road and we got some airflow, that will drop down. 250, we got a good 25-30 degree drop on the inside from the temperature here. So we're all good on this system here. So that pretty much completes the job. We'll go ahead and disconnect all of our hoses. I will take the car for a test drive and make sure everything works good, and then we'll deliver it back to the customer.